I have the honor of introducing Governor Scott Walker. In November of 2010, Governor Scott Walker was elected the 45th governor of Wisconsin, inheriting a $3.6 billion budget deficit, $800 million worth of unpaid bills, and an 8% unemployment rate. He continued the efforts he had made in the Milwaukee County Executive Office and immediately implemented reforms to renew economic revival, fiscal order, and government accountability in Wisconsin. Governor Walker became the first and the only good governor in American history to survive a recall election on June 5th, 2012, and was reelected for a second term in 2014. Governor Walker serves on the boards of Students for Life Action, American Federation for Children, and the Center for State-Led National Debt Solutions, and most importantly, he now serves as the president of Young America's Foundation. Please join me in welcoming Governor Scott Walker.
Well, thanks. Good afternoon, everybody. Having a good time?
Yeah.
Did you like our speakers thus far?
Yeah.
Yeah, some good folks. It's great to see high school students from all across the United States. I was thinking, in fact, earlier, right before Liz Wheeler came on, and that was intense, but really helpful, I thought, listening to all that Liz had to talk about today. But in that panel that we had with the two gentlemen who had once been military aides for then President Reagan, I was thinking about that because timing-wise, how many here, by the way, I know we've got high school students. Anybody a freshman in high school here? Okay. So to all of you who are freshmen, although these days, I don't know if we can say freshmen because it's just got men in there or something like that. It's fresh, whatever, yeah, fresh person, right? Fresh, whatever you want to be. But for those who are in your first year of high school, put it that way. I was in my freshman year in high school in 1983. So I'm probably the age of your parents or older. But I was a freshman in March of that year. So almost exactly this time, 40 years ago. I was a first-year student at Delavan Darien High School. It was a local community high school at the time. I loved Ronald Reagan. I actually loved him from earlier on. My father and I remember watched him even way back when I was a little kid in 1976. But he gave a speech that year in March of 1983 that people today call the Evil Empire speech. It really didn't come across that way initially. It was, interesting enough, it was a speech we just talked about a couple weeks ago because it's his anniversary. It was a speech that would have fit well with some of the stuff we talked about with Admiral Quinn and Ambassador Carter. And I want to fill you in on that because it goes to this larger topic of good versus evil. So we're going to talk about not only in military terms, but we're going to talk about some of the things that Liz talked about, some of the other speakers have talked about, but this distinction between good and evil, and then we'll open it up to take some questions from you on that or anything else you want to ask about, including whether or not Aaron Rodgers is going to play for the Packers next year or not, which Greta Van Susteren was just asking me about on TV upstairs before all this. But good versus evil. So in this speech, in large part today, people, historians and people who love to talk about the Reagan era, look back and call it the Evil Empire speech. But it was a speech that was about a variety of different subjects, a couple of which I'm going to talk about. But one in particular that got tied into the phrase the Evil Empire was he was talking about the Soviet Union. And the whole debate at that time, as I ask a little bit about the two distinguished gentlemen who were up there with me about not only their time as the military aide for the president, but also just being in the military at that time, all the challenges, the Cold War, all the intensity. As kids at that time, we were worried about nuclear proliferation. Mutually assured destruction. It meant if the Soviets shot off all their nuclear weapons, we would, you know, it'd be mutually assured destruction. We would all be largely blown up. So it was pretty intense, pretty horrible times. And Reagan wanted to bring true peace. But unlike the president today, who somehow believes that appeasement or weakness is the way to go, which unfortunately I think opens the door to evil here and around the world. But in Reagan's case, he believed in peace through strength. And so he believed in rebuilding the military, having a strong military position, not to go to war, but to avoid it, which might seem counterintuitive, except if your opponents know that you're strong, it's they don't want to take you on. You see it in a variety of different areas in life, not just in the military. But anyway, at the time, so he was making the case about why we need to rebuild the military, why we need to be strong, and why we need to push for bringing down nuclear weapons But in particular, he chose a speech not to a military group. He didn't do it in front of one of the military academies. He didn't do it in front of some think tank about these issues. He actually did it at a meeting of the National Association of Evangelicals. Now, why do you think he did that? Well, he wanted to talk about the difference between good and evil. And he talked about a bunch of issues. Again, we'll touch on a couple of those in a moment because it's more than just military. But he talked about in particular because he said at the time, there were a lot of, not necessarily at that event, but other church leaders of different faith traditions who were trying to say that both the United States and the Soviet Union were equally as bad, equally as ill-informed, equally as guilty for this building up of this nuclear arsenal and being on the brink of a nuclear holocaust. And he said that he wanted to point that out, that we need to stop apologizing because our efforts were not to be aggressive, they were to be defensive. In fact, years later, one of the key movements in bringing down what we now refer to as the old Soviet Union was a visit to Reykjavik, which is in Iceland, where he was having a debate with then the leader of the Soviet Union, Mikhail Gorbachev, who later came to the Reagan Ranch years after that. That's back when, you know, that slab of the Berlin Wall you see when you come in the door here was still up, separating East and West Berlin, both physically and figuratively a symbol between freedom and oppression that we saw there and we saw with communism all throughout Europe at the time and into the Soviet Union. But he made a point that in that visit at Reykjavik, that he was pushing in all these talks about bringing down the number of nuclear weapons, that he had to have what was called the Strategic Defense Initiative. His opponents, his critics at the time called it Star Wars, as it was some fantasy crazy idea. It was his idea of building a shield to block the United States, and he offered, put it on the table and say, we'll offer it to the Soviet Union or anybody else who wants to partner with this. But this idea that when nuclear weapons are shut up, they've got to go up out of the atmosphere and then come down, and that there'd be a shield out to protect against this. And all sorts of critics in the media and elsewhere said, oh, that's just crazy. It's Star Wars. It couldn't really happen. If you remember about a year and a half ago when missiles were shot into Israel, and in the middle of the night you saw those images on social media and throughout the media, really amazing images at night of all these missiles blowing up in what was called the Iron Dome. It was this dome, figuratively. It wasn't literally a dome like you see in an Avenger movie, but it was a dome-like system that blocked, that shot off missiles or counter ballistic missiles to stop the missiles from coming into Israel. The Iron Dome in Israel is exactly what Reagan talked about with the Strategic Defense Initiative years ago. So anyway, his idea was we build up all these things to be defensive, not aggressors. And he wanted to make the point in front of all these religious leaders at the National Association of Evangelicals 40 years ago this month that we needed to stop apologizing and realize that we needed to counter the efforts of an evil empire. That's where that speech came from. That's where that phrase came from. I would argue today it goes beyond, much more beyond just the leftover remnants of the Soviet Empire with what's Russia today and what Vladimir Putin's doing, not just in Ukraine, but would like to do elsewhere. But I think in particular we see it, again, with a little bit what you heard about at lunch, with the Chinese Communist Party, to me, is the new evil empire. And that's certainly true from an international standpoint. But I also think a lot of these battles go down to good versus evil, not just when it comes to foreign policy. But think about it. I was talking to a couple of students before this. If we talk about the protection of life, for example, I think that's not just a difference of opinion. I think that's a fundamental difference of good versus evil. I find it hard to believe, and I realize I can respect maybe people who have different opinions, but to me it's real simple. If you acknowledge that an unborn child is a living, breathing human being, it's hard to fathom the idea that, well, everywhere else in society outside of the womb, we make that punishable in some states, not only with life imprisonment, but in some states even with the death penalty itself, and I'm not advocating for that, but if we make that punishable to take the life, if that's a serious capital offense, why isn't that the case when that child is still living and breathing but just happens to not have been born at that point? It's just not... I was telling one of the students here, it said, one of the interesting personal stories for me is I have two sons, Tonette and I have two boys, 28 and 27. Our firstborn's named Matthew. My wife was a widow before we were married, so she didn't think she'd get married again, let alone have a child. So our firstborn comes from the Hebrew word for matan, which means Matthew, is a gift from God, a gift from Yahweh, because that was our special blessing. We were blessed again with another son after that. But I look at that, and I remember when Tonette was pregnant with Matt, he ended up being a colic baby, which had explained he did a lot of kicking inside of her stomach when she was carrying him throughout her pregnancy. And so there was this Kenny Loggins lullaby back when they had DVDs, or not DVDs, CDs, far before you were around, but before we had, you know, things on our phone, you could put these CDs in and play music. And so she bought this Kenny Loggins one, and there were all these wonderful lullabies, and she'd have me sing them. And on days when he was really kicking hard inside of her stomach, I'd get right down at the end of the night and sing that lullaby right into her stomach, and the baby would stop kicking. And then later, when he was born and he was colicking a little crazy, sometimes it would take going back to singing some of those same songs to calm him down. The reason I tell you that is not just because maybe it's cute, but because to me it was clear. That wasn't some clump of cells. There was a baby in there. It wasn't like I injected some medicine to deal with a pulled tendon or something else like that. I was singing to my son, and it calmed him down and it stopped the kicking. And to me, it's just hard to imagine, again, good and evil, how to imagine when I was your age, the debate over this issue wasn't just about whether abortion should be legal or not. Basically, back then, you had a lot of politicians who would just say, I think abortion's bad. I disagree with it. I would never personally be for it, but I think it should be left up to someone else to decide. You know, you've heard it, the phrase, a woman's right to choose. Well, that was the case that they still acknowledged it was not something they personally were supportive of. I don't know if you see it in your schools or much your age group, but definitely in college, you're going to see people who are celebrating abortion, who aren't just saying debating whether it should be legal or not. They're actually celebrating it. You see these Hollywood stars who go to protest and yell and scream about how wonderful it was to have an abortion. I got to tell you, my reaction is not to get mad at him. My reaction is actually to pray for him, because I think there's some real trauma going on there. And one of the things we need to do when it talks about a battle of good and evil is not just to stand up for good, but to stand up and realize, hey, we've got to show these people some compassion. We need to show people love. To me, we win not just in this issue, but so many other issues by showing we want the best for them and everywhere else in society. And sometimes, and again, this fits in well with the stuff we just heard about TikTok and some of the other algorithms and social media, I think there's all this pent-up issues out there. I think more than just left and right, frankly, if I was China or I was any of these other enemies that we have around the world, one of the great tools of social media that I've seen far beyond just TikTok is all this hatred that's built up. One of the best things I did about 6 months into being governor was I stopped reading all comments about my social media posts. I still look at, you know, if there's someone I like or admire, I might look at Ben Shapiro or maybe Liz Wheeler or somebody else, their Twitter feed, but I post something, I don't read the comments after that. And I'll tell you why. About 6 months in, maybe even less than that, amongst all the other obnoxious stuff that was being posted about me, there was about a 40-year-old gentleman at the time who had worked for my predecessor, which meant he was a Democrat, but he had been the head of the Milwaukee office. I'd been the Milwaukee County executive. This gentleman I'd seen, we'd known and liked him. We'd worked with him. Obviously, our politics weren't aligned, but there were a lot of issues that go beyond partisan politics. And this gentleman I had sadly seen online in one of the newspapers had died. I knew he had had an organ donation and was trying to get that to work, and sadly it didn't. There was a story about him passing away. And I tweeted that story, and I just said how sad it was, because even though our politics weren't always aligned, he was just a decent, wonderful man, and I was sorry to hear about that. That was the last time I read comments, because three or four comments down, instead of talking about him, they started trashing me on something else. And I just said, I'm talking about a guy who's a Democrat, who I worked with, who I liked, and you can't even for a moment give it a rest to stop trashing even in a moment of tribute. Like I said, I'm done. I got to tell you, it was one of the most liberating, most healthy things I've done. Because I think part of our problem, more than just inherent bias, more than just control, like we see suggested about TikTok from the Communist Chinese Party. I think one of the biggest challenges we have with good and evil is that it's just, there's so much negative talk on social media. In fact, it's a good reminder that Twitter in particular is not real life. You know, every year there's a survey that's done nationwide of all the people who are on different forms of social media on Twitter. Pew Research finds out that about, historically, it's been about 22 to 23% the last few years of all the people in America are actually on Twitter. And of that number, about 80% of the tweets are done by 10% of the people. What that tells me is that anytime when you see something trending, you know what that means? If you do the math, that means less than 5% of all the people in America are part of that trend. And yet, a lot of people who live on Twitter, and particularly a lot of lazy journalists who use Twitter as though it's a sounding board for the rest of America, think that that's real life. That's real life. Somebody the other day in one of our interviews asked me, you know, what should we do to try and bring people together, to bridge the gap, to do it? I said, put our phones down. Get off of social media for a while. Actually talk to people. One of the most optimistic things I find crisscrossing the country is there's a lot more as Americans that bring us together than divide us along the way. Now, that doesn't mean fall back from your principles, but that means that most people, even those that don't agree with us on everything, I don't think buy into the radical agenda that we see on social media, that we see in colleges, that many of you see on your own campuses in high school, that we see all throughout movies and Hollywood and elsewhere. But it's driven by the loudest, most obnoxious people out there. And many of them, not all, many of them are just part of an evil effort to take America in the wrong direction. Liz alluded to this a little bit too as well, but I think it's true. You know, Marxism never really worked in America. There's a reason for that. In fact, in a way, obviously you all got a chance to go up to the Reagan Ranch yesterday, but anybody been to the Reagan Boyd home in Dixon, Illinois? I know we have some programs there, so a few folks have been there. It's not a good place to go to conferences, particularly if you're from the middle of the country. But being at the Reagan home, one of the interesting things is it's not as, you know, it's not as mountaintop experience literally as it is here, but there's a great story to be told. So Ronald Reagan lives in five different homes. One of them we have there, and same thing as here. We don't just have it to go to the property. We have conferences like we're having here. But of those five homes, we have the one, and of those, every single one of them his family rented. They didn't own. And each of them got progressively smaller. Anybody have an idea why would they get smaller even though this family size didn't change? Have an idea? Well, what happened was his father, who by all accords was a good and decent man, hardworking guy, but sadly suffered from addiction. His addiction at the time happened to be alcohol. And so he'd go on a series of days where he was too drunk to work, wouldn't show up, and lose his job. And they'd have to move to a smaller house. And to keep the family afloat, Mrs. Reagan, Nell, would go out. She had a series of odd jobs. She would do different things. She would sing for weddings and funerals. She would sew. She'd do some other things along the way. She taught some classes. But each time Jack lost his job, they'd have to move to a smaller house. And years later, when Ronald Reagan graduated from high school, he went to college, but he didn't go to some Ivy League school. He went to Eureka, which was a small nearby community college. And then he worked for a couple years on the radio, working some odd shifts in the state of Iowa, just across the river. And eventually, yeah, he went out to Hollywood, mainly because of a recommendation from some folks who were connected to Dixon. But he didn't. He wasn't a traditional movie star. He wasn't like we would think of today. He was a star in what were called B-movies. As I was saying earlier at lunch, those were like the opening act for a concert. And so here's this guy who certainly wasn't born in high class. If you look around the world, you know, the kind of people who are leaders, the kind of people even traditionally in America were thought of sometimes as leaders, where people went to Ivy League schools, had all the right credentials. Well, that wasn't Ronald Reagan. And there's a lot of people like that, not only in politics, but business, entertainment, sports, and elsewhere, who didn't come out of a certain class, but who were able to live their piece of the American dream. Why? Because you could do that in America. Because even though we haven't always lived up to every aspect of the American promise that was declared on July 4, 1776, the promise is there that all of us are created equal, that our rights come not from the government, but from God.
and that ultimately they include not the least of which are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And so we live in this country where all of us, from the time we were started, from the very declaration of our independence, we said we're created equal. Again, not always living up to that, but on the path towards a more perfect nation. Well, that, to me, is one of those fundamental differences between good and evil. If you look elsewhere in the world, for all the talk about how great socialism is, you only need a slight amount, a slight dosage of history to know that it isn't. You know, for all the examples of socialism, Marxism, communism, they just don't work. Bernie Sanders and his allies would say, oh, well, you know, look at the Scandinavian countries. That's just not true. The Danish prime minister repeatedly will tell you that they don't live in a socialist economy. They have a market-based economy. They have somewhat generous social benefits, but they're not a socialist economy. Socialism just doesn't work. Think of Cuba. You know, before COVID, you know what the minimum wage was in Cuba? Anybody have an idea? What do you think the minimum wage was in Cuba?
50 cents.
50 cents? It was actually much higher than that. What do you think? What's that? $5? It actually was $17. But it wasn't per hour. It wasn't per day. It wasn't per week. Before COVID, the minimum wage in Cuba was $17 per month. Think about your cell phones. Parents are probably paying the bill on that, but they're not $17 per month. You wouldn't have a cell phone in Cuba. Yeah, no, they throw in, oh, you got free transportation, free housing, free health care. You know, the riots a year and a half ago in Cuba, in Havana, outside of the Communist Party headquarters, you know why they were rioting? And you can have, this is not about whether your opinion is for or against vaccines. There are riots there because they couldn't, none of them, even the people that wanted it, could get access to vaccines for COVID. Because for all the talk about socialized free healthcare, what they do in Cuba is they train people to be medical professionals and then they farm them out for money to other places around the world. And the people in Cuba kind of get the hand-me-downs. They kind of get whatever's left over. It's not a very good place. It's not a very good place. And we see that in the old Soviet Union. We see that in Venezuela. Venezuela, a country that about 20 years ago was the second wealthiest country in this hemisphere. Today, there are literally food lines. There are literally lines for food the last few years in Venezuela, like there was when I was a kid in the old Soviet Union. To me, that's the fundamental difference between good and evil. Good and evil. And it goes back to not just our government. You know, one of the biggest worries I have for all of us, but it particularly applies to Generation Z, is that last year the Gallup poll showed that we're now at the point in the surveys out there where we have the lowest number of people who believe they have a faith in God. Not shockingly, in a similar poll around the same time, we're also at the lowest level of people in America who say they're exceptionally proud to be Americans. I think the two go hand in hand, you know, God and country. I happen to be a Christian. I'm not telling you have to be a Christian. That's a great thing about America. You don't establish a state religion. You can believe in what you want to believe in. But I think the fundamental lack of belief in God, whomever you might believe that is a falling point. If you look around the world, part of the Soviet Union wasn't just the oppressive nature of communism. It was de facto, essentially, a push for atheism. We see it in communist China right now. They tried to supplant the government, literally in the translation of the Bible. Mike Gallagher, one of our friends who's a congressman from Green Bay, Wisconsin, pointed out last year at one of our conferences that the latest translation of the Bible in communist China actually substitutes some places references to God and inserts the government. Because in these regimes, communist Marxist regimes out there, what they want to do is have you put your faith in the government. Sadly, far too many radicals on the left, that's where their focus is. They believe in the government. It's why we saw during COVID. What did they do? They wanted the government to tell you whether your school could be open or closed. I got to imagine some of you who are homeschool students, maybe before COVID you weren't, but your parents said enough is enough. We're getting you out of these schools, not just because of the lockdowns, but looking at the curriculum and all the other craziness going on. You know, there's a whole bunch of people who were exposed during COVID, not to the virus, but to the fact that they overwhelmingly, blindly wanted to put their faith in the government. And that's what people on the far left do. As conservatives, the good that we focus in on It's saying we put our faith in the individual, in the family, and ultimately in the government. Ultimately in God. The other side puts in the government. We're in the individual, the family, and God, whoever that God might be. And again, I have a personal opinion about that. And in fact, in some ways, it even ties in when you see these attacks through critical race theory, the 1619 Project. We'll talk about race, and they'll attack founding principles because of the failures of some of the founders. My response to that is simple. I don't know of a perfect person who's lived on this planet in some 2,000 years. And there's only one before that I know of. The rest of us all have failures to some degree or another. The key is not focusing on them as much as trying to repair them, to improve on them, to do better. And obviously some of our founders didn't live up to everything in the American promise, but that doesn't mean the things that our country was founded on. The belief that all of us are created equal, that God gives us right, not the government, that we need to stand up, and that's what governments are for, is to justly protect those rights given to us by God, are just so fundamentally important. I'll give you one more quick example, and then I want to open the questions. It ties into both what you saw yesterday at the Reagan Ranch, and if you get a chance to go to the Reagan Boy at Home, you'll see in Dixon. So when we were in Dixon for the first time, you go in this small little house, and like I said, the others were progressively smaller, but upstairs, even though they didn't have enough money to buy a home, they were living paycheck to paycheck, living on a shoestring. Mrs. Reagan, they always had a house that had three bedrooms. So the president's mother and father would have one bedroom. The president had one brother, and he and the two of them would share. And then they always had one open. Now, they had it open for a couple reasons. One, she was always cautious, wisely so, as we later found out, because she was worried that if Jack lost his job, maybe they'd have to rent one of those rooms out to somebody who needed to rent a place to stay. In addition, when they weren't doing that, Mrs. Reagan was a devoted Sunday school teacher at her church down the way, and she went so far as to really live her faith through her life, and she would do a ministry down at the local jail where she talked to men who had been imprisoned, and occasionally when they were let out of jail, if they needed a place to stay, they could stay for a couple days at the Reagan's home. Years later, in fact, that became such a significant thing that when Ronald Reagan was at Eureka College, two of his classmates who were on the basketball team at the time, two of the members of the team happened to be black. And back then, about a century ago, unfortunately, in that community, that hotel operator wouldn't let the two of them stay there. And so the president told his mother, and his mother said, well, they're going to stay with us. And so they stayed at their home. And so you see all these examples of the impact, the influence, both in school and then college, that the family there, Mr. and Mrs. Reagan, had on their children. And one in particular was she would do these odd jobs of singing at weddings and funerals. But occasionally there were people. It was a tough time in the nation's economy. It was right going into the Great Depression. And so there in the Midwest, there were oftentimes people who needed her services, say, for a funeral, but didn't have the money to pay her fee. And so she was a very charitable person. And she would say, okay, well, she'd understand the situation. But she also knew through her time in the church that you have to respect people's dignity. It's not just charity, that there has to be dignity with that. And so what she would do, she'd say, well, even if you don't have the money now, I understand that. But when you do, if you've got some time, instead of paying this all off, why don't you just go to a yard sale? We'd call today it'd be like a rummage sale. Why don't you go and find me a saucer and a cup? She says, I like to collect them. And she didn't really need them, but she said that. And so they would bring them along the way. And you'll see in the house there today, there's replicas of all these different saucers and teacups that are there, all different styles, all come from yard sales along the way. And she would pray for each of those families because she'd know, as bad as things were for them, there was somebody who even faced more dire circumstances. If you look fast forward to your trip yesterday to the Reagan Ranch, one of the things you remember going to the ranch house, there's a spot where you come in that front door where the bookcase is, you go around by the bumper pool table, and you look in that opening to where the bar and the kitchen is just around the bend, obviously a very small house. And on those shutters that open up to that window, there's leather pieces on either side. Now, I don't know if you didn't hear this, I'll bring up the speed, but that leather was done by a couple siblings in the Cisco family. When Ronald Reagan was governor, they sent a letter to then Governor Reagan saying their brother, who had a developmental disability, wasn't able to get the services he needed from the state government, and they were asking for then Governor Reagan's help. Well, in addition to getting him directed in the right place, then Governor Reagan had great empathy. Empathy, I believe, that he got in many ways from his mother and his time in the church. And so he remembered what she taught him, and it wasn't just to be charitable. He didn't just give them money. He got to know them, understood that they made leather work, and so he got them to do a number of projects. That particular shutter project, he had them do while he was running for president of the United States. And if you notice the little letter down in the by the table there, he actually sent them a letter thanking them for that work in November of 1980 after he had been elected president of the United States. So even in the middle of what I say is like drinking out of a water fountain, he still thought it was so important to thank them for the good work they'd done, recognizing the dignity of their work and of their time. I tell you, in the larger sense, I think that was fundamental to him, and I would say fundamental to all of you, that he understood that true freedom and prosperity, a very biblical concept, do not come from the clumsy hand of the government. They come from empowering people to live their own lives and control their own destinies through the dignity of hard work. That's one of the things, unfortunately, we don't hear enough about in society today. You know, some of you are going to go on to college and pursue careers that will require a college degree, and that's great. You're going to be wonderful. Some may even go on to graduate school, to law school, to medical school. Others may go to a technical or community college or go into an apprenticeship. But each of you along the way, hopefully remember the honor, the dignity that comes from hard work. You know, it's what Solomon said in Ecclesiastes. It's about finding joy in your labor, whatever your labor might be. Those are fundamental truths that are about good versus evil. There are others who want to, you know, tell you to have the government do it all for you, to just be dependent, rely on the government, to have the government pay everything off. It's part of the reason why we're in such a national debt. It's counterintuitive to those good fundamental principles, and we've got to counter that going forward. So with that, I'd love to take some questions again on this or anything else you'd like along the way, and appreciate you guys all being here.
Yep, so if you have a question, please go ahead and line up behind with Jamie.
Please line up by Jamie.
Then you can come up, state your name, and what school you go to with your brief question.
Hi.
Hi, my name's Ryan Hill, and I'm from LUOA. And this question is pretty off topic from your speech, so
I apologize.
But I just wanted to ask what your opinion was on the gold standard.
We should return to a gold standard. I think that's been obvious for quite some time. If you're looking at a good book at this, Steve Forbes, who's been a longtime speaker, in fact, one of my sons brought him when he was at Marquette on the campus, wrote a great book about the gold standard, the flat tax, and pushing back on Obamacare and going to a market-based, patient-centered healthcare system. But I think we fundamentally need to do that. And I think it's there's no better time to explain it than right now with the failures we've seen just up the way in Silicon Valley.
Good answer.
Thanks.
Hello, my name is Diego Duarte. I'm from Christian High School. So since conservatism has its roots in Judeo-Christian values, and with you talking about atheist communism and talking about like the link between like atheist societies and these sort of ideologies, what do you think like we should like do when considering about like secular humanists or atheists that just happen to believe like conservative values? Do you think that could be a danger just trying to, through like Big Ten conservatism, like reach out to these people, or do you think they should be their own group, or should they be under the conservative label?
Well, Ronald Reagan once said, you know what you call somebody who agrees with you 80% of the time? You call them an ally. And so I think particularly in this climate, we need as many allies as possible. I think one of the biggest mistakes is trying to push people out of any movement. Doesn't mean you need to agree with them, doesn't mean you need to sacrifice, actually agree with them on every issue. doesn't mean you need to sacrifice your principles. But I think it's fundamental to pull people into the movement. As a Christian, I would add to that, I think beyond just politics, I think, you know, this sounds like a cliche, but I think it's true. You know, follow the model of Christ. One of the things over the years, not only enjoy reading the Bible, if any of you got a chance, this is a personal thing, not a YAF endorsed issue one way or the other, but I love watching the last couple of years, The Chosen. Some of you have watched it too. If you haven't, it's actually, it doesn't cost you anything. It's a free app to watch on. But one of the reasons I like it, and it's based on many different books in the Gospels, but many other elements of research about it, is because it very much personalizes not only Christ, but his disciples. And, you know, which I believe is true, but it's kind of fun to watch this. I believe Jesus actually had a pretty good sense of humor. I love watching him interact. I love watching his mother Mary interact with the disciples and others. And to me, it was just another vivid reminder watching this series about how, you know, all throughout the Bible, we see that he calls us, you know, to be true. He doesn't tell you to back away from it, but to draw closer to people. That's why I mentioned, and this is why I'd say it beyond just as a Christian, but with those Judeo-Christian values, is be a happy warrior. You know, Reagan talked about that a lot. Be an optimist. I mean, for goodness sakes, God puts you in the greatest country in the history of the world. Part of the reason why the left is so negative, so nasty, so over the top, so radical about these things is because they want you not to understand that. Yaomi Park, who stood up this last fall on this podium, who was just with us at a college conference in Dallas, who was just on campus the last few weeks with us, she defected from North Korea. She talks about how awful it is in North Korea, but how she made her way to America after all this horrible abuse, all this pushback, everything else she got. I mean, literally, in her case, she literally had sexual assault, talk about abuse, makes her way to America with her mother, ends up at Columbia University, and after a semester, she can't believe her ears and eyes. All her classmates talk about how awful America is, how they all want equity. She said, well, my ancestors were all promised equity by the previous leaders of North Korea, and all they had to do was give up the freedoms and rights, and what did they get? They got equity. They're all equally poor and oppressed. You know, that's the problem here, and so I think we need to be happy about it, point out the facts, but as I was saying to some of you before too, don't just talk about the logic, talk about it emotionally. You know, when I give that example of Cuba, when I talk about people like Yao Ming, when I talk about others along the way, tell your own personal stories. I think one of the great things about your generation, as much as sometimes people give you grief, is that more than any generation before, I believe you believe in authenticity and fairness. So be authentic. When you want to share your story, don't just read what the textbook says. Apply it to your own circumstances. Apply it to the lives of not only you, but your friends. Apply it to others. And then talk about it in terms of fairness. It drives me crazy when Joe Biden talks about wanting to raise taxes on the rich for fairness. You want to be fair? Do a flat tax. Everybody pays the same. That's why the Bible says 10%. It doesn't say more for this person, less for that one. It says 10%. That's a tithe. It's the idea that we should, according to our ability, I said, flat tax is pretty simple. If you make 10 times more than me, you pay 10 times more in taxes. If you make 10 times less, you pay. Those are all fundamental principles that to me come out of that Judeo-Christian value system. And we should be happy warriors about that. Not back away from our principles, but find ways to bring people in as opposed to pushing them out.
Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Joaquin Couch. I'm from Mother of Divine Grace. And my question is, do you think Twitter has improved at all ever since Elon Musk took it over, or has it basically stayed the same?
That's a great question. Improved depending on how, I guess it depends on how you define improved. I think the ability for people of different viewpoints to be heard has improved dramatically since the purchase by Elon Musk. Has the quality of the content, or I'd say more specifically, the tone changed? No, but I don't know that that's up to Elon Musk or anybody else running it. It's up to the users. Again, it goes back a little bit to what I said the last one. I think we can all make points, but
unfortunately, the people who want to be the biggest Twitter stars in the universe typically have to talk smack about everybody to get the kind of followers, and sometimes not just on the left, but on the right. I mean, why else is AOC up there? AOC has done literally nothing in Congress. It's why even if you talk privately to Democrats in the Congress, they tell you they can't believe that she's such a sensation. But she's saying all sorts of wild and aggressive things on Twitter. It's why sometimes some of the people, the biggest followings, are some of the folks who say some of the most obnoxious, nastiest things out there. Now, doesn't mean you shouldn't call people out if they're speaking things that aren't true. But I think Twitter won't change. Certainly shouldn't be the government. It's not even going to be up to Elon Musk. It's ultimately going to have to be to all of us who use any form of social media to raise the standards and raise the quality of the things that we see and read on social media.
Thank you.
Hello, I'm Carson Hamblin from Legacy Christian Academy, and my question is, given the positives but also the negatives, are smartphones a net positive for today's society?
Boy, that's another great question. I saw a meme, ironically, on social media, but a meme, somebody talking about Generation Z, which is my Generation X, which is my generation, and they laughed, but I'm not messing with Generation X. I was paraphrasing here, but you know, we're the first kids that in the summer got left alone all summer long, that didn't come home until the sun went down, the lights came on, that drank out of the hose out of the side of the house, that scrounged around to find food on our own somewhere else. They said, I'm not going to mess with this generation because they know how to get things done. So yeah, I laugh about that thing. A lot of, you know, we didn't have, our phone was something plugged on the side of our wall. And if we were going to hang out with our friends, we made a plan the last time we saw them and told them we'd meet up, and somehow we got by. We made things happen. Now, having said that, I'm not naive enough. I'm not like the cranky old man saying, well, just get rid of phones, because that's not possible. And, you know, I too depend on my purchases, when I check in out of the airport, when I go through clear, a lot of my life is on my smartphone. I do think, and I'd say it's any age, not just yours, but I think it's not whether it's a net negative or positive. It's just, I think we all need to be mindful of how much time we spend on our phone and find ways to put it down. I travel a lot, and I got to tell you, you know, instead of seeing people praying, I see a lot of people bowing to their phones all over airports. Which, by the way, gentlemen, just one little weird, quirky thing to say. You probably don't travel a lot now, but gentlemen, do not use your cell phone at a urinal in a bathroom. That is just totally wrong. I see it all the time when I travel. There's just common decency out there. I mean, frankly, even in a bathroom in general, male or female. But if something's that critical, you need to take a break, because if you can't use it while you're in the bathroom, there's something wrong about that. But to that point is, I just think my kids, like I said, are about probably 9-10 years older than you. When they were in high school, they'd sit in our living room and they'd have their friends over, and I'd see them texting each other across the room. And I finally said, if your friend's over, talk to him or her. Stop texting each other across the room. They're a human being. I get it if they're on the other side of town, they're at the house, but you know, it's one of the things that's nice about all this. You can actually talk to each other. And again, I'm not just singling out your generation. I think a lot of your parents and grandparents spend too much time communicating via their cell phone and not enough in person. And I think we saw, one more thing to add to that. I think we saw, a lot of you unfortunately were victims of this, we saw the downside of not having human interaction during COVID. Sky-high numbers of mental health issues. I think there's something inherently important about being able to be around people, to see them, not just on Zoom or on Skype or on FaceTime, but actually be with them, to see their emotions, to pick up their body language, and have empathy, to feel for people. And sometimes it's simple as just give them a hug, put an arm around their shoulder and tell them it's going to be okay. I think the more we can do that, the better off we'll be.
Thank you.
Sure.
Hi, my name is Jack Millette from Legacy Christian Academy. My question is, you brought up before the battle between good and evil. You also mentioned your faith in God. How should we as Christians respond to Christian leaders who say Christians should not get involved in the culture war and in politics?
Well, that's saying you're not getting involved in life. I just don't know how you can't do that. Politics comes from the Greek word people. So you're saying you're not going to interact with people? Which, by the way, my dad was a minister. There's more politics in the church than there is in government. So there's politics everywhere in life. I just think it's fundamentally important for everyone to be actively involved. If you believe there's good and evil, if you believe there's right and wrong, you need to be able to stand up and act on it. And I hope one of the things, not just for me, but from the other speakers thus far and even through tomorrow, you learn, and for those of you who have been at other conferences, you know we repeat some of this along the way, not only for high school, but eventually if you go into college. Part of standing up for your beliefs doesn't mean you don't have to stand up and have a debate. You don't have to stand up and yell as loud as the others are yelling back. You don't need to stoop to some of their tactics. Sometimes it's just as simple as asking questions. Excuse me. Where'd you get that from? Well, that's funny because the thing I read said something completely different. Why do you think that's true? In fact, I had when I was facing a recall election, one of my trooper's sons was at one of the University of Wisconsin campuses, and he'd play this game. He could stump people on three questions. He'd be about where Madison is in the back, and they were signing recall petitions to get me on the ballot for a recall election and the student union, and they'd come up towards him as they signed it, walk his way. He'd say, well, why'd you sign that? He'd say, oh, well, Scott Walker's awful. I said, why is he awful? Oh, well, he's hurting education. How's he doing that? I got to go to class. A couple questions in, they couldn't figure it out. And so I think to your point, to me, the better answer than removing yourself from society is engaging in it, but being a model not only in what you say, but how you say it. I think as a Christian, I think that's true, but also as a conservative. When you have in your school or someday in your college campus, when someone is radical, just over the top obnoxious, your response to that person probably 9 out of 10 times is not going to change him or her. But there are probably a whole bunch of other people watching to see how you respond. I think that's true in life. That when people ask me why I didn't lash out when I had death threats, when I had pushback, when I had people shut down events I could speak at as governor, they said, why did you never lash out at them? I said, because I had my most important audience wasn't them. It was my two sons, Matt and Alex, who were in high school. And I wanted them to see that no matter what people throw at you, no matter how obnoxious they are, no matter how awful and indecent they are, that wasn't the way to respond back in kind. That instead you could be strong and firm and make a difference without having to stoop to the tactics that they were engaged in. And so that's why in many ways, having gone through that, I got to tell you, I can appreciate, even though it might seem completely distant, what you as students in high school and again, someday maybe in college will experience, because it's the same factor these days. It's intimidation. On social media, maybe in a classroom, maybe on a campus, maybe just in society in general. When they tell you, as heard at lunch, when they tell you no, there's 27 different genders, and you say no, God made men and he made women, and we need to be respectful of each, but you can't have 27 or 35 or 54 different identities. You can't name yourself 100 different pronouns. When we say no, God made us all in his image, and the best thing we can do is not single one group or other out by race or ethnicity or background, but rather say each of you are individuals. God made every one of you unique. And the uniqueness, a part of it may be how you look, not just in the skin color, maybe the color of your hair, maybe the style, but it's also about what family you came from, where you came from, what sort of music you like, all sorts of other influences out there. But God made each of you unique. That's what's great about America. Our motto is e pluribus unum. That means out of many come one. But the beauty of this country is we don't tell people when they come to America, and more people come here than anywhere else in the world by far. It must not be that awful a country if people literally come here at higher percentages than elsewhere around the world. But we don't tell people you have to give up your identity, give up your culture, give up your ethnicities, but that then together there's a common bond. And I got to believe from our ancestors, a big part of that was this idea that coming to America would provide opportunities and freedoms, not just to us, but to future generations that are unheard of in many other parts of the world. So those sorts of things to me, I think are things worth fighting for and why we should be engaged, particularly for those of us who are Christians.
We have time for one final question.
Hi, my name is Eliana Wilson, and I am homeschooled in Minnesota.
Fellow Midwesterner.
Yes. Neighbors, actually, right next to Wisconsin there. But my question starts with the many years that I spent in public school education, and having some lovely liberal teachers gave me some interesting interactions where... we once had an unprepared day where I ended up debating an entire class of 28 on abortion. And one of the people who were at that time my friends said that she would have understood if her mother had aborted her. And as a Christian, that really hurt my heart, because in Psalm 139, it does say that I knitted you together in your mother's womb and I know the most innermost parts of you. And I just wanted to know, looking back, what your response might have been if someone had said that to you.
Well, one, as I was thinking about this when I had the night that the day that the decision came out for Dodds in the Supreme Court this past year, I was at Canisius College up in Buffalo, and someone asked us or made a similar point, asked a question, talked about abortion being healthcare, and then unfortunately, as typically you see on campuses with speakers, not just me but others like you heard today in the last couple of days, they ran out. They didn't wait for a response. They just said it and ran out. And one of the things I said then, I just said earlier, which is particularly on that issue, but others like it. One, I always try to think, take a step back and realize, well, a lot of those folks, maybe not been in that case, but a lot of folks, there may have been some personal traumatic, whether it was through her or someone else in her family or others had gone through. And so that's that added trauma that comes to the situation. We got to be careful to respond, not just to lash back out, but to respond with love and compassion and understand that there's, you know, a lot of people hurting, and a lot of the hurt involving this issue is because of personal experience. But I also try to personalize it. So sometimes I talk about Matthew, I mentioned singing, and I still remember his first ultrasound picture was him turned on his side and you could see his thumb going in and out of his mouth. And I knew I was pro-life before then, but I just fundamentally, how could you not see that? But I also try, when debating this issue in the past, I remember once I was in the state legislature and this issue came up back then, Tonette was pregnant again, this time with our second son. And thankfully, it's not a qualified, this, so it didn't actually happen, because it would be horrible if it did. But I said, imagine if we were in, then we had a minivan being parents. I said, imagine we're in the minivan and a drunk driver came and smashed into our minivan. And as part of that accident, not only injured Tonette, again, this didn't happen, but imagine if it did, injured her, and in doing so, not only injured her, but caused her to lose our son, who would be unborn at that time. I asked the people I was debating in the legislature at the time, I said, forget about the law, forget about politics for a minute. I said, just as people who know me, I said, many of us here have difference of opinions on a wide variety of issues, but I hope we have a personal relationship that's at least respectful. I said, if that example had happened to my family, would you send me, my wife and I, would you send us a get well card or would you send us a sympathy card? I said, because I believe any decent person would send that family a sympathy card, because they would have known that that mother was pregnant, and that drunk driver smashing into the car not only injured her, it killed the unborn child. I said, if you'd send me a sympathy card, if you'd send our family a sympathy card, how can you deny that that wasn't a living human being that was lost? I said, forget about the law. Just feel what's in your heart. unfortunately, I think on that issue is indicative of a whole bunch of others. I mean, you could unpack this on so many different subjects. The left, in large part for control, weaponizes that issue, trying to make people, particularly young women, feel like there are people who want to take their so-called rights away, instead of, I believe, looking to their heart and knowing that on that issue, it's not a legal issue. It's one that goes to the heart of who we are, and that that's a human being. But I think that's true, again, on gender and race and other things. Those who want power want to divide America based on race and sex and gender issues. They couldn't do it when it came to Marxism because we're not a class-based society, like I mentioned, talking about Reagan's raising. That's a good example amongst many like that in America. You heard it from a couple of the speakers earlier today. People are living the American dream regardless of class. So they're now, because that failed, trying to grab power again based on race and sex and gender, even if that's not really what they're fighting for. And so what we've got to do is they make these arguments emotionally based. We shouldn't cede ground on the logic, but we need to find ways to tell it from the heart. And so whether it's on the right to life, whether it's standing up for the way God made us on gender, particularly when it comes to children, I got to tell you, no matter what people think in general about that idea, and in America, people have a right to feel differently when they're adults. But I don't know why on all 50 states, not a one of you under the age of 18 could get a tattoo. But in some of these states, they still would allow you to get a sex change, even though I know with my kids, even till well in their 20s, they couldn't figure out, you know, how they wanted to comb their hair, let alone some of these other factors out there. The reason we don't allow minors to get a tattoo is because you're not only not of the age of consent, because that's pretty hard to change. Imagine how much harder it is to change after gender-specific surgery. And so on all these issues, I just think the left is trying to respond emotionally to pit one group of Americans versus another. We need to respond logically, but from the heart, in a way that shows compassion and really gets to the heart of these issues. If we do that on all these issues, again, goes back to good and evil. If you know in your heart something is good, it makes it a lot harder for the opposition to oppose it, and a lot easier for you to defend it. But talk about the why, not just the what. In politics, all of us get wound up quite a bit in talking about what, meaning this bill, this idea, this concept, as opposed to telling you why something's important. If you never lose sight of why you're fighting for something, the what will make its way through. So
thank
great.
You.
Thank you, everybody. Appreciate it.